your program here. I'm here to introduce our speaker here tonight. So, Dr. Fitzsimmons comes to us from the Department of Oceanography here at Texas A&M University. She graduated summa cum laude with bachelor degrees in both biology and chemistry from Boston University. Y'all are so all right. Anyway, so she went across the Charles River to MIT and got her PhD in chemical oceanography under the direction of Dr. Edward Boyle. And then she did a quick stint over at Rutgers working with Dr. Robert Sherrill. And then in 2015, she began here as a professor at Texas A&M University. The coolest, like literally, thing I saw in her CV was that she's apparently been to both the Arctic and Antarctica. I'm sure she'll talk about it here. So with that, let's give her a figurative, warm welcome, all right? So here's Dr. Jessica Fitzsimmons.
Hi, I'm Jessica Timmons. It's really nice to see all of you guys. I've never been up here on the stage before. Only been in the audience with you guys, so, and I apologize for my voice. I have a little bit of a cold. Thanks for having me, and I'm really excited to talk to you guys today about how we use chemistry in the ocean, and how we use all the different elemental personalities. My students make fun of me because I call the elements my friends, because you get to know them like you know a dear friend, and you use them to understand ocean properties. So I want to talk to you guys about that. Yes. What I'm going to talk about is a brief tour of the personalities of elements in the ocean, a brief tour. And really highlight some snapshots of how we use those elemental personalities to understand ocean and earth processes. And finally, the majority of the research in this presentation will be what I think is a pretty cool story about my favorite element, which is iron. I hope all of you guys have a favorite element. How about you just yell it out right now? The first person who yelled the loudest yelled helium, and that was great. I am going to talk about helium today. Did anyone say iron like me? Anyone? Anyone? No? Okay, well, I hope to convince you that iron is really cool. I'll help you understand how we use elemental personalities to understand iron cycling in the ocean, which is part of what my research is about, and why that's important to understand. But first, the real reason that I signed up to give this talk is because, you know, not too long ago, I was in your shoes. I was a first-year student at Boston University, where I was pursuing a bachelor's in chemistry. I understand you guys are pursuing a lot of different degrees. At Boston University, they have a really strong synthetic chemistry program, at least they did at the time that I was there. And the pharmaceutical reps were coming when I was there, and they're like, oh, we'll give you this much money right away, and, you know, there's a gym and a Starbucks, and you can live right in the building, and, it, you know, you never have to leave, and I was like, uh-oh, I don't know if I want that. I kind of want to be able to go out into the wilderness and do things, but I really loved chemistry, and where I struggled was understanding the range of jobs that were out there for people who had chemistry skills. What other jobs were there? This is me in college, playing in a glove box under a nitrogen atmosphere, no oxygen. You know, Novartis and Merck and all these big companies came and interviewed me and offered me these crazy jobs, and it was way more than I could handle. And I didn't think I wanted it. So I had a conversation with my advisor, who's here, John Caradonna. Maybe some people know him. He said, you know, it was just a random day that I talked to him, and he said, you know, 10 years ago, I had a student who decided to pursue chemical oceanography. Have you heard of that? And I was like, nope. I'm from Miami, Florida, but, you know, I like the ocean. I don't know what oceanography is. And so I took a class, and that conversation changed my life. So I do want to tell you guys a couple of professional development tips. My first career lesson number one, have as many conversations about your career with as many people as possible and as often as possible. It's really important. You never know which conversation is going to change your life and help you get the job of your dreams. So start talking about it early and often. All right, so there's lots of jobs available in chemical oceanography and environmental chemistry. These positions require really strong analytical chemistry skills, so I recommend that if you're interested in this, you take a class in analytical chemistry. You get a good grade. In oceanography, I recruit students, and I'd rather have students that have strong chemistry backgrounds because those foundations are irreplaceable. And I do want to highlight how environmental chemistry is different from what you guys are doing in first year chemistry. I think you guys have assumed ideal conditions a couple times, huh? Who's assumed ideal conditions? Yeah, okay. Unfortunately, the environment is rather non-ideal. So you can't assume ideality. We have lots of impure solutions. That's kind of the point, and that's kind of the fun of it, right? And you're not always at standard temperature and pressure. You go swimming at the bottom of a deep pool and your ears pop. You swim at the bottom of the ocean and you implode. So, got a lot of pressure down there. So, we're definitely not at standard temperature and pressure in the seawater system. Also, the goal is kind of different. Chemists are often trying to build more complex compounds or use chemicals in useful ways. We're trying, as environmental chemists, to separate chemicals and isolate them and measure them or their isotope ratio in order to understand the process. So instead of building, we're trying to separate and take apart and measure with high accuracy and precision. So my career lesson number two is when you take classes through your undergraduate career, think hard about what you're good at and what you're not good at. And you're allowed to have both. I have both. Know what makes you happy. The things that you're good at and the things that make you happy aren't always the same thing. So keep looking, because somewhere they're going to overlap, and that's going to help you guys decide what you want for your career. Happiness has always got to win. Always, always. So I'm going to plug chemical oceanography. We get to travel all over the world. That is one of the true highlights of my job. This is me at the North Pole with my sign. You would think I would have prepared better and brought a more awesome sign. I did not. So here it is on the side of a cardboard box that I made right before we arrived. It was cold. We had to wear a lot of clothes. And also, there was Santa and a pole. Isn't that surprising? I bet you guys didn't know that was up there. Another thing I want to say is this is me in Antarctica in a penguin colony. Been to Antarctica twice. Geosciences takes you anywhere you want to go. Anywhere you have a question about, you get to go and visit. It's really awesome. This is me off the coast of Africa. These are off of Hawaii. This is in the North Atlantic. And in the North Atlantic, I get to build things. I get to measure things. I get to grow plankton and other cool bugs in the lab. I get to do kind of whatever my heart desires, which is the best part about being a scientist. Environmental chemists also use the entire periodic table. Really cool. Talk about having a lot of friends. A lot of friends. And a lot of people ignore stuff. How many of you guys have thought about the lanthanides and actinides at the bottom? Nobody, right? Did anyone pick a favorite element down there? I bet not. Oh, someone did? Oh, hey, yay. Way to go. So, I wanted to show you guys an example that the lanthanides, which are these guys way at the bottom of the periodic table, the first row of that bottom section that hangs off. In earth science, we call these rare earth elements, and they tell us a lot of useful things. There are people who make their entire careers measuring them. Cool, huh? So most of these rare earth elements are trivalent. They've got a plus 3 oxidation state. Exceptions are cerium, which also has a plus 4 oxidation state that's rather insoluble. So in the presence of oxygen, which we're going to hope that we're in the presence of oxygen, that cerium gets removed from solution. So people plot these rare earth elements kind of all in a row. Here they all are, lined up in a row. And you can see that cerium in seawater, which is what this line is, goes down in concentration. And that's because the cerium is removed under oxygenated conditions because it forms an insoluble plus 4 species. Europium is another example, another exception in the rare earth element chain. It has a divalent oxidation state, so it gets the plus 3 oxidation state is enriched under oxygenated conditions, but under reducing conditions, in the absence of oxygen, you get this divalent oxidation state. And so what's really cool about this is that we can use the rare earth element distribution. See, this one has a positive europium anomaly here to tell us that this fluid formed under reducing conditions, where you have an excess of this divalent oxidation state, the lower oxidation state, and this fluid, seawater, formed under oxygenated conditions. So if you had a fluid and you weren't sure what its history was, you could measure the rare earth elements and it would help you understand. Pretty cool. I also chose rare earth elements because I want to mention to you guys, rare earth elements are also increasingly being used in modern technology like your smartphone, your LED screen, your rechargeable batteries, especially in hybrid cars, and your computer hardware magnets, all the parts that make your computer go. We are running out of these rare earth elements on land. And so folks have decided that they are going to turn to the ocean floor to mine these rare earth elements. They've built these huge machines, and they have these plans to send these machines down and suck up all of these special rocks at the bottom of the ocean called manganese nodules that form at like a rate of 0.2 millimeters per million years or something ridiculously slow. So to get to the size of a baseball, you can imagine how long that took. And they're going to suck them up into a vacuum onto their boats and mine these. This is pretty scary for us oceanographers. This has really unforeseen ecological impacts, and right now we have an attitude of out of sight, out of mind. Who thinks about the bottom of the ocean regularly besides me in this room? Oh, hey, a couple people. Yay, friends! Not very many people raise their hands, right? So it's pretty easy for us to do this, but anything you guys can do or think about or lobby for in order to get at least some environmental assessment studies out there would be helpful. All right, so we're going to talk about the elemental personalities. This is my favorite version of the periodic table that has every single box in this version of the periodic table has the ocean's depth on the y-axis going down, so deep is down at the bottom, shallow at the top, and it shows the concentration as it goes down in the water column in each box for every element in the periodic table. Isn't it a beautiful thing? And you can see that there's a lot of variability here. You know, some of them, some of them go straight up and down. Some of them increase with depth. Some of them decrease with depth. There's a lot of variability here. And we can break these behaviors down into four personality types, four rough personality types. The first, we call the conservative type, and that's the easiest one. It's straight up and down. It's constant everywhere in the ocean. Pretty easy. And why would it be constant everywhere in the ocean? Well, I hope what you guys have learned in first year chemistry is that things that react are not constant. So these elements are inert. They're just there, and they go around and around in the ocean, and they don't change very much. Pretty boring. I'm going to point out ways, though, that we use these to our advantage, so listen up for those. There's also nutrient-type elements that have increasing concentrations with depth. These are controlled by biological processes. These elements are used in cells in useful ways. So you might expect an element that has a nutrient type profile to be carbon. Right? We know we use carbon in cells, so when carbon is taken up from the surface ocean and it goes into cells, that removes it from the surface ocean. So it has a low concentration at the top and a higher concentration at the bottom. Those are the nutrient types, the biological ones. There's also adsorb type elements that have decreasing concentrations with depth. You can see here, aluminum is an example of this. They have high concentrations in the surface because that's where their source to the ocean is, like a river or dust. And then they decrease with depth because they are quickly adsorbed onto particles. Adsorbed is a funny word, I realize, because usually you see absorb. I didn't misspell it, I promise. So absorb means you absorb into something, and adsorb means that you absorb onto a surface of something. So there's a lot of elements in the ocean that, for a variety of chemical reasons, are sticky. They like to stick to surfaces of particles. And these types of elements get removed from the ocean pretty quick because particles are falling down and sinking to the bottom of the ocean. And finally, there's these hybrid type elements that have mixtures of profile types. So they might be used in cells, but they also might be sticky onto particles. So they have really complex cycling. And just as a little bit of a teaser, iron is one of these hybrid type elements, and that's part of what makes it so awesome. There's lots of jobs that you could get if you were interested in these types of processes. The first is a first environmental chemistry job you could get would be someone interested in toxicity and studying toxicity of elements. There's lots of jobs, people who do these kinds of things, federal jobs, like working for NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, or the EPA, Environmental Protection Agency. And also state jobs. TCEQ is the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality. They have a lot of monitoring people all over the state who are measuring concentrations of different toxins in different water bodies. And then there's tons of environmental consulting and private firms where analytical skills for measuring toxins are valuable. So in order to get a job like this, you need strong analytical chemistry skills. You need to be able to measure things well. Get the right number and without error. So these folks specialize in the analysis of toxic compounds, sources, sinks, biotoxicity to, you know, the food we eat, to us, to all kinds of things. And many of these toxins have the adsorb type personality. They stick to particles, they stick to organic matter or cells, and that's part of what makes them concentrate in areas that become toxic to us. My lab in oceanography does some research on these metal toxins. For example, who here remembers Hurricane Harvey? Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was not good. So a week after Hurricane Harvey, during Hurricane Harvey, we were frantically writing a proposal to get down to Galveston Bay to study the effects of Hurricane Harvey flooding on Galveston Bay. Which, for those of you who don't know where Galveston Bay is, Houston is right here. And Galveston Bay is this big estuary where freshwater and saltwater mix before it reaches the Gulf of Mexico. So we got out there a week after Hurricane Harvey to look at the effects of Harvey on toxin concentrations in Galveston Bay. And you can see there's a river that comes in here, the Trinity River, and another river that comes here through Houston. These rivers carried elevated concentrations of toxins after Hurricane Harvey, which was also reported in the news, like the E. coli water. You know, did you guys remember that? Oh, I don't think there was E. coli, but there was lead. Just so you guys know, lead was is a neurotoxin. There were not sufficient lead concentrations to hurt anybody, but they were elevated. Additionally, we measured arsenic, for example, in the sediments, and so this is in June, September, and November of 2017, the year Harvey hit. Harvey hit 1 week prior to this, and you can see the change that happened over time. These red concentrations are higher levels of arsenic And so you could see Harvey brought higher levels of arsenic into the sediments of Galveston Bay. Cool stuff. So, you know, our remaining questions are, you know, can we use lead isotopes or arsenic speciation to help us understand whether these sources are natural or anthropogenic or both? And what do catastrophic events like spills and hurricanes do to these waters that maybe some of you grew up swimming in? Kind of scary. I also want to mention that there are other chemical oceanographers at A&M that also measure toxic chemicals. For example, Dr. Yina Liu is an organic geochemist. Maybe some of you guys are organic folks. She studies these per- and polyfluoroalkyl substances that are found in Teflon and firefighting foam. These have carbon chains that, instead of having hydrogens attached to them, they have a fluoride attached to all of them. And what this does is it gives these compounds more hydrophilic, water-loving character that allows them to move through aqueous systems really easily. And they have evidence of adverse health effects on humans, but they're in our water and they concentrate in our cells. So this is something that she's actively working on. Another one of our professors, Dr. Katie Schamberger, measures pH in seawater, especially the effects of increasing anthropogenic CO2 concentrations on ocean acidification. Who here has heard of ocean acidification? All right, I like that. So this redox reaction, water plus CO2 in redox space gives you life, right? Sugar and oxygen, we need that reaction to happen. This exact same reaction, H2O plus CO2 in acid-base space, gives you, oh, sorry, I forgot the subscript, but gives you H2CO3, carbonic acid. And it's this reaction that's causing ocean acidification. As we have increasing CO2 concentrations in our atmosphere, those exchange with the water and drop the pH of our seawater. This is an example of what happens when that happens. These are oyster larvae. Oysters, right, they're in shells. They need calcium carbonate shells. And as we get under acidic conditions, those shells can't form. So they start to break down. So these are the healthy cells under normal CO2 conditions, and these are the unhealthy larval cells under acidic conditions. So this is all, she studies the effects on corals, the effects on oyster fisheries, the effects on plankton ecology. All of this is happening in oceanography, and all of these labs that I'm mentioning, not only are they all women, yes, but they're also all happening, they all require a lot of analytical chemistry skills. So if you think that measuring things really well is something that you're good at, you have good attention to detail, and you're great at these kinds of skills, think about these kinds of jobs. All right, the second kind of job you can get is as a tracer chemist. Again, many federal agencies and state agencies employ these. What is a chemical tracer? This is one of my favorite parts. It really takes advantage of elemental personalities. It's an element or molecule that has a unique personality that allows you to track a process that's happening on Earth using that element's properties. So the chemical tracer must have process specificity, but otherwise be pretty boring. That's what we're looking for. Things that can target certain processes. An example of this are sodium and chloride. They're really unreactive. Salt and seawater, all they do is respond to evaporation, which concentrates their concentration, or precipitation, rain, which dilutes their concentrations as they mix around the ocean. So they and sodium and chloride and salinity, which is mostly made up of sodium and chloride, are the perfect tracers for understanding ocean mixing and evaporation and precipitation. And what we a lot of times do in the ocean is we'll plot things versus an element concentration versus salinity. If we get a straight line, then we know that that element has only mixed around and responded to evaporation and precipitation. It's boring. It's just mixing. I think that's boring. No chemical reactions. Boring to me. Unlike this element, where here's where the straight line could be, and this is what your data look like. though you have less of your element of interest than you should, assuming just mixing, and that means you've had some removal of that species in addition to mixing, which is kind of cool. And we wouldn't know that unless we plotted it versus salinity, because both of these look like just decreasing concentrations, right? So unless you plot it versus salinity, you can't tell if it's just mixing or if it's an additional chemical or biological process. Like this could be biological uptake as you increase along a salinity gradient. So this shows that sodium and chloride are really useful tracers of mixing. Anything that goes beyond those tracers is something more than mixing. So another example of this is argon. Who remembers where argon is in the periodic table? It's over there, right? It's over there on the side. What column is it in? Can you yell it out? Noble gases, that's right. And the noble gases are known for being, well, noble, clearly, but they're inert, right? They have full electron shells, so they don't want to react. They don't want to form ions. So how would we use something as boring as argon? Well, it turns out that we're really interested in the ocean in oxygen, and I heard many of you guys say that oxygen is your favorite element. I understand why, you know, because of life and all. So when we make a line as a function of temperature of what our dissolved oxygen concentration should be in seawater, that's this solid line here. And you can see that all of our concentrations, which are the dots, are above that line, which is kind of interesting. Why would that happen in seawater? Why would we be getting more oxygen than we expect? Well, I think two reasons. One, photosynthesis produces oxygen. So if photosynthesis is happening in the surface ocean by these plankton, then we would be producing oxygen. Or it could be because there's lots of bubbles that are just injecting oxygen into the water, forcing it to be what we call supersaturated in concentration, have a higher concentration than it should. And in order to test that, we're going to use argon as a chemical tracer. Why argon? Good question. Thanks for asking. So argon and oxygen have very similar solubility as a function of temperature. So they're like twins in solubility space in water as a function of temperature. But argon, biology doesn't care about argon. You can't get energy from it. Not very useful in a cell. So all argon is doing is mixing, but bubbles affect argon, right? So what oceanographers have done is they've developed methods where they can go through the ocean and they can measure the oxygen to argon ratio, and that corrects for the effects of bubbles. So if there's a bubble injection or some mixing process that's happening, it's going to happen to argon the same as it's going to happen to oxygen, but the biology is only going to affect the oxygen. So what this tells you is a really cool tracer for photosynthesis and how much photosynthesis has happened in a certain area of the ocean. Isn't this cool? And they can measure oxygen and argon like straight from the ship. They have sensors that make these measurements really easily. So really cool developments. At Texas A&M, we do have another chemical oceanographer who's a tracer gas oceanographer. He specializes in measurements of CFCs, chlorofluorocarbons, in seawater. These are not only ozone depleters, but they are also very potent greenhouse gases. She also works with methane and other greenhouse gases and uses primarily gas chromatography and mass spectrometry. This is another analytical chemistry tool in order to understand the effects of these gases on a changing climate. So I've mentioned a lot of these names, lots of women. That wasn't because I'm excluding the men, but it just so happens that the chemical oceanographers are all women. Kind of cool. But if you guys are interested in any of these things, please reach out to me or any of these faculty members for research opportunities. We're always looking for motivated students. It's me. I'm a biogeochemist. I like to consider that an elemental accountant. Accountant. Yeah. Who here wants to be an accountant? Yeah. That's what I thought. But I'm an accountant that gets to go to the North Pole in Antarctica, okay? But really, what I do is I measure how much of each element is in any given spot in the ocean, and I try and think hard about where it came from and where it's going, and what that might mean for the biological implications of that element. So I wanted to show you guys, I'm part of a big international program that's trying to measure biologically relevant elements all around the global ocean. So what you're looking at here, this is South America, this is North America, this is Africa. So this is the greater Atlantic basin. Antarctica's down here, North Pole's up here. And this is the distribution of dissolved iron as a function of depth all across the North Atlantic Ocean. This took millions of dollars and many people's years to make this figure. So we're very slowly starting to get a handle on how dissolved iron concentrations change through the ocean. And I'm talking about iron, as I said, because it's my favorite element. And so I want to mention, this is sort of how we think about it. Biogeochemists think of the ocean as a box, and we have arrows going into and out of the box. And we are accounting for the size of those arrows. Big arrows good, little arrows don't care. So for iron, for example, dust, big arrow, dust, very important. I know, I studied dust, kind of funny. Rivers, not so important for a variety of reasons. Sediments, really important. Biological uptake and remineralization cycles, this is biology, very important. And I'm going to talk a lot about this arrow here, hydrothermal vents, which happen at the bottom of the ocean. Who here has heard of hydrothermal vents? Oh, cool. Well, I'm teaching a class on hydrothermal vents this semester. Y'all should take my class. It's real fun. Okay, so my favorite element, iron, is the fourth most abundant element in the Earth's upper crust. It's 3 to 7% of total ocean crust, upper crust by weight. So this is the ranking of how abundant elements are in crustal materials, aka rocks. And with respect to elemental personalities, iron is a hybrid type element, which means it's a nutrient for cells and it likes to absorb onto the surfaces of particles. So it has very complex cycling, way too complex to be a tracer for anything, but we use other tracers to understand it. And you can see this is a typical iron profile with depth in the ocean. And you can see it has low concentrations in the surface. That's characteristic of biological uptake into cells. And then you can see it reaches a maximum at mid-depth and then kind of starts to decrease again, which shows its particle sorption characteristics. Importantly, iron has two oxidation states, +2 and +3. In oxygenated seawater, +3 is the most normal oxidation state of iron. And unfortunately, iron-3 is really insoluble. It likes to be a solid, but it will precipitate rapidly into iron oxide hydroxide particles. I think you guys are probably pretty familiar with this via rusty cars. Love to make some rusty cars, right? You gotta take care of your car if you don't want it to turn into that. I think it's kind of cute, but I think other people don't think that. So, importantly, as a result of this like rust formation process, which is a solid precipitation reaction, dissolved iron in seawater has very low concentrations, nanomolar. That's 10^-9 molar. Yikes. When you guys are working in the first year lab, you're not doing anything in nanomolar, I promise. Everything's way higher concentration. To give you some perspective, dissolved sodium in seawater, it has 100 million times. There are 100 million times more sodiums than there are irons dissolved in seawater. So not very much iron. This will become important. Because who cares if dissolved iron is low? Well, Popeye cares. He really does. He needs to eat his spinach, and part of why he's eating his spinach is because it's rich in iron, and that helps him grow some muscles. We all care about iron. It's on our nutrition labels. the planktonic plants living across the surface of the global ocean also care a lot about iron. These plants are pretty important to us. They are responsible for half of the photosynthesis on our planet, which means every other breath you take, we could sing a song there, but we won't. Every other breath you take is due to these photosynthesizing plankton in the surface ocean. Okay? You don't know that they're there, and really, when they are there, they make green water, and you look at that and you say, ew. We all do, and that's okay. But they're photosynthesizing, producing half the oxygen on our planet. So iron is a critical metal center for the cellular proteins that are involved in that photosynthesis reaction, cell transporters, and et cetera. It's essential for life. They need it. And if we think about the elemental stoichiometry of those photosynthesizing plankton called phytoplankton, you can come up with this recipe, if you will. You could do this for your own body as well, right? I don't have that number off the top of my head, but it wouldn't be too far off from this. And so what this means is that they need 7.5 irons for every 147,000 carbons. So they need a lot more carbon, it turns out. But if we, this is the demand, right? This is what the cells are demanding of the ocean to provide them when they're trying to grow. And if we combine this with what the ocean is supplying them, what the concentrations are across the surface ocean that they're growing in, what they have available for bioleptic, and we put that into a model, and we say, what runs out first? Who had to do a limiting reagent calculation this semester? Yeah, we just did it across the whole ocean. Cool, huh? So these phytoplankton, they run out of iron first in 40% of the surface ocean. All of this blue area, they're going to run out of iron first, according to these models, which is pretty cool. It means that iron is really important. And it also means that if we were going to fertilize the ocean with something in order to make more of these phytoplankton to grow, we would have to fertilize them with iron. And the guy who came up with this is John Martin. He came up with this, perhaps not in your lifetime, but within my lifetime. So this is a very young field. We just discovered this way too late. And he did these experiments where he dumped a whole bunch of iron in the ocean, and he watched in a satellite from space. This is chlorophyll A concentration, which is chlorophyll's, right, the pigment that's in plants. And he watched, and he saw from space that phytoplankton grew in response to the iron that he dumped. So iron is definitely the limiting nutrient in a bunch of these areas. And as a result, it's pretty important. In fact, many of you guys may have heard about geoengineering proposals for climate mitigation that involve fertilizing the ocean with iron. Well, that's not going to work. I can tell you that as a chemical oceanographer. I could have given my whole talk on that, but I'm not going to do that. But I will say that phytoplankton growing in the surface do take up CO2, and they, when they sink and die, they do sequester that CO2 in the deep ocean or in the sediments. And this is what we think is responsible, these changes in atmospheric CO2 concentrations over hundreds of thousands of years in the Earth's history are responsible for glacial-interglacial cycles on our planet. So you guys have probably heard about, you know, the last glacial maximum when, North America was covered in ice, right? That was a time when CO2 concentrations in our atmosphere were a lot lower, and so it was colder. Hence all that ice being able to form. And when you look at that, CO2 down, temperature down, iron up. And you can see it every time that you have a drop in CO2 in the Earth's history, you have a drop in temperature, you have an increase in iron and dust deposition. And so we think that the delivery of iron to certain parts of the ocean through this, what we call the biological pump happening in seawater, is part of what sets climate changes over the last 500,000 years. So iron's pretty important. And so that's nice because I spend like my whole life thinking about it. So there's three parts of my chemical job that I do on a regular basis. The first is I go out to sea and I collect samples. It's kind of fun because I measure iron, really low concentrations in seawater, and I collect it from a ship that's made out of iron. Oops. So we go through a lot of trouble to make sure that we have not contaminated these samples at all. This is what we do. We've got this, what we've called a rosette here. It has a sensor package in the middle that measures temperature, salinity, depth, oxygen, a variety of things that you can put on there. And we line that rosette with these bottles, these gray vertical bottles here. And you'll see soon that we lift this up with a crane and send it out. This A-frame here moves out on the ship. This is in the Arctic Ocean. And this is me getting it ready. And so we get this whole thing ready. We even put a seatbelt on it, which you'll see in a minute. And then we send this thing out. And every single one of these bottles will collect us water from one depth. So we send it down. We're looking at the temperature and salinity as it's going. And as it's coming back up, we tell it through a computer that translates information through this wire. We tell it, collect a sample at that depth. Go, machine, go. And it brings us up water from all these depths of interest. The second part of my chemical oceanography job is I measure metal concentrations and isotopes. You guys are very lucky to be at such a great research institution. We have amazing analytical facilities on this campus. The one that I use the most, I'm the co-director of the Radiogenic Isotope Geosciences Facility, which is in the Hal Booty building on the third floor, kind of by a chemistry building. And we have two inductively coupled plasma mass spectrometers that I use regularly. We actually have three in the room. The first is called the Element XR, and the second, a brand new instrument that I just helped us get. This is a $1 million instrument. It's like the size of a room, not this room, but a room, a normal room. And this one measures concentrations, and this one measures isotopes. And here's how it works. It's really cool. It has this ICP ion source, inductively coupled plasma. This plasma is made up of argon. What did we say argon is? A noble gas. That's right. It does. It is very happy with its full shell of electrons. And so what we do is we use some high-frequency alternating current to rip some electrons off of argon. Now, I don't know about you, but I can tell you, argon is pissed. It does not have its electrons. It is mad. And what's great about that is that argon plus, which we formed in this plasma, this thing is so mad that it has turned the temperature of the surface of the sun, okay? This sucker is hot, and it is mad. And it is going to ionize anything that you put in its path. So we've got a universal ionizer here, which is really great. So ICP mass spectrometers can measure basically the whole periodic table because you use something that wants ions, wants electrons so much in its argon plus. It goes through an electric sector that separates energies and a magnetic sector that separates things based on mass. So this allows you to choose what element you want to analyze, and then it has some detectors. This instrument is basically this, plus it has a multiple detector system on the end for simultaneous detection of multiple isotopes of the same element, which is really great when we're making isotopic measurements. Seawater, though, is really salty. Remember, there's 100 million times more sodium ions than iron at any given time. And so salts build up in our instrument and block our sample flow path. Our sample has to pass through this, like, little teeny tiny pinhole. I should have shown an example of what one of these things looks like when it's clean, because these are both super dirty. And basically, salts will build up in that orifice and occlude our orifice and cancel our flow of our sample, which is bad. So we've got to get rid of the salt. It's pretty important. And we go to a lot of effort to do that. We use these metal-binding organic resins that have functional groups that are very electronegative and will bind metal ions really well. And we have this system in my lab that does this in an automated sense. So it pulls up your, has like this arm, and it pulls up the sample. It puts it through its column where it passes through these resin beads where it pulls in the metals and rinses it out, blah, blah, blah. All the salts go to waste. Great. They can go to waste. We don't want those salts. And then we get the metals in the end, and we can concentrate them and measure them more easily. So the last thing that I do in my job is once I get the concentrations, I spend a lot of time interpreting the ocean iron. Where did it come from? Where did it go? And who cares? So this was my iron cycle here. I said dust is really important. This is the coast of Africa here from space, and this is a giant dust storm blowing off the coast of Africa. There is a ton of dust blowing over the North Atlantic Ocean. Other parts of the ocean, not so much. This is the coast of Louisiana showing sediment inputs coming out of the Mississippi River and the Atchafalaya River. All of this material that you can see from space is sediments coming out of these river systems. All of these sediments are rich in iron. The thing I'm going to talk about today is these hydrothermal vent systems. Check my iron. These hydrothermal vent systems here. And what's cool about this is compared to dust and sediments, we can ask ourselves, do hydrothermal vents provide a significant supply of dissolved iron to oceanic phytoplankton? Based on my picture here, you would guess no, because my arrow is real skinny, right? And I said size of the arrow is size of the flux. So you're guessing that I'm saying no. The reason, just want to give a little intro to hydrothermal vents. These happen at plate tectonic boundaries where the plates are moving apart. The Mid-Atlantic Ridge is a great example of that. It goes down a mountain ridge that goes down the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. Tectonic plates are moving apart there, and we get these hydrothermal vents that form. And they have these characteristic black, they look like black smoke. This is underwater. We're at 2,500 meters depth here. So we're pretty deep. So this is not actual smoke. This is particles, iron-rich particles, in fact, that are precipitated from hydrothermal fluids. So these hydrothermal vents are a very metal-rich system. They happen because seawater percolates through this young ocean crust. And there's a very shallow magma chamber here that heats up this rock material. And under hot and acidic conditions, you dissolve the rock, the young, newborn baby rocks. You dissolve them away and create vent fluids that have dissolved iron concentrations that are a million times higher than in the deep ocean. Okay, so talk about a big source, a million times more than deep ocean iron concentrations. The problem is that this is under no oxygen conditions, and as soon as that fluid hits ocean seawater, it hits oxygen, and it precipitates quantitatively, we think, two solid phases as iron-rich minerals near the vent site. So it comes out, and it's a million times more concentrated, and it forms a solid quick. So with this a million times iron enrichment, you would only need like less than 1% of it to stay dissolved to make an impact on ocean iron, and that's exactly what we're trying to figure out. This is called the leaky vent hypothesis, which is the idea that some hydrothermal dissolved iron stays dissolved, doesn't form a precipitate, and contributes to global ocean dissolved iron and could even feed those hungry phytoplankton in the surface ocean. There's lots of evidence for this all over the ocean. This is, you know, Indian Ocean, Arctic Ocean, Pacific Ocean, Atlantic Ocean, South Atlantic Ocean, like everywhere. We have these indications that we have high iron. The problem with these is that this is all near the vent site, where we might expect them to still have some remnant iron. Our question is whether it makes it far away from the vents and contributes to the ocean dissolved iron inventory. This is where the elemental personalities come into play. We can use helium. I heard helium as someone's favorite isotope. Helium is a great hydrothermal mixing tracer. There are two helium isotopes, helium-3 and helium-4. the atmosphere has mostly helium-4 because helium-3 is lighter, and its terminal velocity, it can escape its terminal velocity and outgas to space. So we're losing helium-3 from our atmosphere. The mantle of the Earth, that's below the crust, we're like in the middle of the Earth now, has 200 times more helium-3 than the atmosphere. So a hydrothermal vent system that has been closer to that mantle source is going to be feeding the ocean with enriched helium-3. And the trick to how this is so fun to use is that helium-3 is inert, so it has no reaction to particles. It just mixes. It's really the perfect boring chemical tracer of mixing of hydrothermal vents that have high helium-3 with seawater that has low helium-3. Just so you know, we measure the helium-3 to helium-4 ratio of our sample. We normalize it to a standard, and we report it as this funky delta helium-3 notation in percent. And you can see in the Pacific Ocean at 2,500 meters depth, there's a huge plume of helium-3 excess that tells us that there's hydrothermal influence across the South Pacific, which is very cool. So, of course, we as chemical oceanographers said we must go straight down the middle of this plume and figure out what's going on with our metals. That's the perfect spot. And so we did that. The National Science Foundation generously gave us more than $10 million. We spent 64 days at sea. We did 80 of these fun CTD tests, conductivity, temperature, depth, where we collected samples. We got 925 dissolved samples and 925 particle samples that look something like this on this boat with Tommy Thompson. And it was totally worth it because we made the cover of Nature. Yes! And we got our smoking gun, which showed us long-distance iron transport in the dissolved phase. This is the depth. Here is the East Pacific Rise, which is where the hydrothermal vents are. So it comes out here, and it moves off to the west for over 4,000 kilometers. What's cool is that this is the helium-3 plume, showing that it's coincident. These plumes are coincident, and so that helps us understand that this has a hydrothermal source. I mean, I don't know what else that could be, but, you know, it's hydrothermal. But notice that these concentrations are decreasing, and so we wanted to use our elemental personalities to figure out, is that decreasing because we're forming particles, or is it decreasing because the plume is diluting away? And that's when helium-3 became really useful, because helium-3 is boring, but it does mix very nicely. And so when we compared our data, which is decreasing down plume, to helium-3, our perfect mixing tracer, we got this blue line, dissolved iron versus helium-3, straight line in dissolved iron space. That means the dissolved iron concentration is just decreasing down plume because it's being diluted with seawater that doesn't have as much iron in it. So that tells us that dissolved iron is persisting from the hydrothermal vents into the open ocean. It's not reacting to form a particle. It's not precipitating. In contrast, the particulate iron is being lost from the plume because it doesn't have a straight line of helium-3. It's curved down because it's being removed via aggregated settling in addition to its dilution. So ultimately, this is important to us because we want to understand, does it reach phytoplankton? There's models of this that turn on our iron source and hydrothermal vents here in the South Pacific. And we say, does that iron reach the surface? And you can see it does reach the surface in some important spots like the Southern Ocean, which is one of those spots that's thought to be iron limited. So when we look at the impact of this hydrothermal iron on carbon and carbon cycling, that photosynthesis in the surface ocean, here in the Southern Ocean, this small amount of iron can have a 30% increase in carbon production in the surface ocean and the Southern Ocean. It's really important. Okay, so I have a bunch of slides on what makes it special, and I think I'm going to skip them because I think you guys are getting antsy and I see some people starting to leave. So I'm going to skip some of these slides. I do want to say that iron isotope analyses, which is what I was going to get to here, these are really hard analyses. The concentrations of iron are so low in deep seawater that here's an analogy for it. It's like taking a teaspoon of Tropicana concentrate and dissolving it in the amount of water of 4 Olympic-sized swimming pools. That's how hard these measurements are. Our mass spectrometers are really amazing. And if you want to measure the difference between iron 56 and iron 54, it's like then trying to taste the difference between Tropicana and Minute Maid, okay? It's hard. These mass spectrometers are fantastic. And we have great facilities here on campus that can make some really amazing measurements. Okay, so I'm going to skip this part. We also get to do some really cool imaging of these particles using X-rays. So there are national labs that we've gone to work in to shoot X-rays at our samples and try and visualize them in carbon space and iron space. So this is the same particle. Where it's hot in carbon, it has white, and where it's hot in iron, it has white. So you can see this particle that's closer to the vent source is rich in both iron and carbon, whereas this particle has this cloud of carbon and these little spicules, these minerals of iron. So it looks very different. So this is really helping us understand that organic carbon is really critical for the persistence of these iron phases. All of the iron is co-located with carbon in the organic phase and in the particle phase and in the dissolved phase. So to ask ourselves what's special about this iron that's persisting, what's special about it is that it's bound to organic carbon. And so this is another time where we're using the elemental personalities of carbon and iron to understand this process. So my conclusions are just that chemical oceanographers are trained chemists. We make high accuracy and precision measurements. We travel the world. We use state-of-the-art instrumentation, and we measure, measure, measure. Elemental personalities really help us understand toxicity, trace chemical processes, and biogeochemical impacts. And I want to end by saying this is really important. So wait, halt, halt, halt. Okay, this is really important. You guys are looking for research opportunities, and I think you should be, even if it's not in oceanography. Consider contacting chemical oceanography professors. We do have an REU program, research experience for undergraduates, and we're looking for younger students, freshmen and sophomores. Students all from all over the USA come to work with us. And my last lesson is start exploring research opportunities as soon as possible. This is the only thing that has allowed me to have a research career at such a young age, is I started right in my freshman year. So get started, guys. Explore, because sometimes it takes you a long time to find your research passion. And thank you.